The Northern Hemisphere is home to one of the world's great animals, the salmon. Historically, they are one of the planet's main biological engines that has fed people, animals, and our forests for millennia. But salmon have suffered a catastrophic population collapse since the Industrial Revolution, and our planet is feeling their absence even if they've long been forgotten in our collective memory. So in this video, I'll give a general primer on salmon, explain what we lost and how it happened, and then dive into the amazing opportunity we have to make things right. Salmon are a cornerstone of Northern Hemisphere ecosystems. What makes them particularly unique among fish is that they are anadromous, meaning they can live both in freshwater and saltwater. The recently hatched salmon, or fry, begin their lives in cold, freshwater creeks and streams, growing and feeding on small insects and larvae. This stage can take anywhere from a few months to a year or two, depending on the species. Then, when they're strong enough, they begin their migration down the river towards the ocean. When they reach the mouth of the river, they take some time to adjust to the salt water and feed heavily to prepare for their new life in the open ocean. Here, the river delta or estuary is critical habitat since it provides what is known in ecology as the edge effect. This phenomenon explains the abundance of food seen at the boundary of two distinct habitats. Depending on the species, salmon live in the ocean anywhere from a year to almost a decade, feeding on krill and small fish before beginning their migration back to the creek where they hatched to lay their own eggs. They can migrate thousands of miles and are a critical part of the ocean food chain for other animals like orcas. They then embark on their final journey, one they've spent their entire lives preparing for. They use daylight hours and water temperature to determine when the time is right, and then they use the Earth's magnetic field and their incredible sense of smell to navigate back to their home river all the way to their specific tributary. No one knows why, but once salmon hit fresh water again, they stop feeding and rely on all the fat stored in their body to navigate dozens, if not hundreds, or even thousands of miles upriver to the streams they grew up in. If for whatever reason they can't find their home stream, they have two options. Either try and find it until they die of exhaustion, or lower their standards and mate with the nearest salmon. If they manage to avoid the hungry bears, eagles, and people along the way, when they reach their natal stream, the females build a nest in the gravel, lay their eggs, and die. The dead salmon are a feast for scavengers that then fertilize the forest with their droppings. This phenomenon is known in ecology as a nutrient pump, where nutrients like nitrogen and phosphorus are moved from the ocean to mountain streams in large, delicious, salmon-shaped packages. This is a critical mechanism for northern forests that is effectively impossible to replace. According to some estimates, salmon carcasses account for 50 to 70% of annual forest nutrient inputs, which, once missing, cause major declines in forest health, biomass, and biodiversity. Now, salmon is a generic term, but the fish is actually a bit more complicated. Salmon break down into two main populations, Atlantic and Pacific salmon. The Atlantic salmon is the only salmonid that is native to the Atlantic Ocean and historically spanned from New England to Canada and Greenland in North America, and from Norway to northern Spain, including the British Isles and Iceland. This species is by far the most threatened, which is directly correlated to the Industrial Revolution happening in England, Northern Europe, and the east coast of North America. So, basically their entire habitat. In contrast, there are a wide variety of salmon species in the Pacific. The big five are Chinook or King, Sockeye, Coho, Chum, and Pink Salmon. On the more niche and exotic side of the scale are Masu or Cherry Salmon, only found in the Sea of Japan and the surrounding forests. And then there's the big debate around steelhead. These are just rainbow trout that decide to play salmon and migrate to the ocean in return. Although not all decide to perform this migration and are known as resident trout. They also don't die after spawning as a salmon would, and some migrate to and from the open ocean several times throughout their life. The different Pacific salmon populations have slightly different ranges, but in general, they're native to Japan, the Korean Peninsula, and the Siberian side of Russia, through to Alaska, Canada, and all the way down the Pacific coast to California. The variety of different species of salmon is cool, but what makes salmon one of the most amazing animals on the planet is their genetic diversity even within the same species. See, since salmon generally return to the specific creek within the larger river system that they hatched in, generation after generation, they become more and more adapted to their native tributary. So, a Chinook salmon from one river can look quite different from a Chinook from a different river. If the river is shallow and rocky, growing to be super fat could prevent the salmon from making it to their spawning grounds, so they may evolve to be sleek and slender. Meanwhile, if the river is deep with a strong current, the fish may need to grow to be massive in order to have enough fat stores to make the journey. The geographical separation of their breeding grounds leads to an explosion of genetic diversity within the same species of fish. While they could technically interbreed, they generally don't unless they get lost and desperate. But it doesn't stop there, because there can also be a temporal separation within the species as well. This deviation comes down to when the salmon actually run, or in other words, when the fish swim upriver to breed. See, a salmon species native to the same exact river can also break into spring and fall salmon runs. Spring usually involves stronger currents as all of the snow is melting off the mountains, while fall usually involves a weaker current and less water flow that can result in more obstacles. So, the same species of salmon in the exact same creek that breed in the spring can be noticeably different from their fall counterparts. This graphic is particularly useful to visualize this. It's a visual representation of the genetic distance or deviation between different geographic populations of the Atlantic salmon species. Another detail about salmon is that they have only ever been native to the northern hemisphere. The warm water around the equator acted as a barrier, preventing them from expanding southward. However, they have now been introduced to South America and New Zealand for both farming and as a game fish. The consequences of this are completely unknown. I don't want to assume they'll be negative given all of the positive effects salmon have in the Northern Hemisphere, but humans don't exactly have a great track record when putting animals where they don't belong. Just ask the Australians about cane toads. Hopefully by now, it's overwhelmingly obvious that salmon are not only an amazing animal, but a cornerstone of the ecosystem. They perform one of nature's greatest acts of service by venturing out of their creeks to harvest nutrients from the sea and then bring them back so that humans, animals, and forests can all thrive. Among indigenous cultures in the Pacific Northwest, the salmon are revered as one of the first foods. Despite their resilience and strength, wild salmon populations are in trouble. Atlantic salmon are certainly the most threatened, with the population dropping from around 7 million to around 4.5 million between 1983 and 2016. And even 7 million fish is already a collapsed population. To put that number into proper context, historical estimates of total salmon returns in the Columbia River are around 16 million fish per year. Granted, it was, and in part still is, a major salmon river. But remember that we're comparing that single river to the total population of Atlantic salmon found in the entirety of the North Atlantic. So, what caused this collapse in population? While there are many accomplices to this crime, there's one clear culprit that pulled the trigger: dams. Simply put, dams cut off salmon from their spawning grounds. If they can't breed, then, well, there's no salmon. What's worse is a single dam can cut off hundreds, if not thousands, of miles of upstream watershed habitat. So any salmon native to any of the upstream tributaries are left without a home to return to. A both tragic and inspiring case study of this is the Klamath River Basin in Northern California and Southern Oregon. Historically, this was one of the most productive salmon rivers in the world, with around 800,000 salmon returning every year. However, the Kopko 1 Dam was finished in 1922 and was followed by several more hydroelectric dam projects along the river. All in all, the projects cut off more than 400 miles of habitat in this watershed, and it didn't take long to see the results as the number of wild returning salmon has since collapsed by 90%, a truly sobering and heartbreaking statistic. The largest obstacle to fixing this sort of catastrophe is generational memory loss. If you don't know that you lost something, it's impossible to miss it. It just disappears. Fortunately, in the case of the Klamath, the salmon were never forgotten by their oldest friends, the indigenous tribes in the Klamath River Basin that they fed for generations. Now, the great news about this whole story is that we know that dams are the main reason for dwindling salmon populations. So the solution is painfully simple: remove them. But simple certainly does not mean easy. Since the early 2000s, the Klamath River tribes have been building a movement advocating for full dam removal. They've fought legal battles, formed unlikely alliances, and finally in 2024 saw the last of the four major dams on the river removed and most of the watershed connectivity restored. There are still a few dams left further upstream, but as it stands, this is the single largest river restoration project in history, successfully opening up more than 400 miles of previously inaccessible spawning habitat. Before this project, the largest dam removal and river restoration project in salmon country was the undamming of the Elwha River in Washington in 2011. That project opened around 70 miles of spawning habitat and is widely considered a success. This makes me really excited for the future of the Klamath, given how much larger the scale of the project is. The best part is that only a month after the removal of the final dam, the first Chinook salmon was spotted in an upstream tributary of the Klamath for the first time in over 100 years. It didn't take long for the fish to find their way home. The planet is at a tipping point, and it's critical that we seize the moment and help nature heal itself. Salmon are one of the keys to keeping our northern forest ecosystems healthy. And healthy forests boost carbon sequestration and biodiversity while helping reduce the probability of catastrophic forest fires. Furthermore, properly managed wild salmon populations could be a great sustainable food source. All we need to do is stop cutting their habitats in half. We can't even imagine the number of salmon our oceans used to hold, but that shouldn't stop us from trying to find out. If you made it to the end of this video, thanks. It means the world to the salmon in me. And if you really like this video, be sure to share it with a friend and keep a lookout for upcoming videos.